I'm Laura Maxwell, and today I'm going to interview Pastor Michael Cummings on the topic of deliverance. Michael, you and I first met through Doug Harris on Revelation TV.
That's right.
About 4 years ago, and we did two interviews with him, which was a great blessing. So normally I meet you in London, but today you've come up to Glasgow. So, and it's been 1968. 45 years ago since you were last here.
That's right.
Yeah.
Different circumstances.
So, welcome to Scotland.
Thank you so much.
It's good to see you here. What do you say to people who feel that Satan is just a mythical figure based on biblical superstition and folklore?
Well, one of the problems in the modern day with the Satan or the devil, or whatever you wish to call him, the media in particular, the TV and the radio, do so many programs now. And what they do programs on deliverance, secular programs on deliverance, where people actually cast out demons or destroy the power of demons. But there's no basis of the Bible used in these programs. They're doing it by their power or their magic powers. And if you like, people are very susceptible to believe in this sort of thing and believe in by certain spells or certain things you say, you can deliver people from demons and evil spirits. The biblical references of Satan, especially in the book of Revelation, portray him almost as a dinosaur, a terrible lizard, a serpentine creature. And of course, people find it difficult these days to see Satan in that form. And he's really not in that form. Satan is ever changing. He changes with the times. He changes with the fashions. Whatever music is popular at the time, Satan is in the midst of it. Whatever political situation is there, Satan adapts himself. So in this modern world where things like deliverance and exorcism are now looked upon in superstitious forms, people are looking for secular ways to understand the occult. So if you like, they've taken away the fear of the devil. In many computer games now, there are demonic or devil-like forms which are overcome by weapons and ray guns and lasers, etc., etc. I think the problem is, if Satan fell in any high street and he appeared in any high street in his biblical form, almost like a Tyrannosaurus Rex breathing fire and growling, people would say immediately, that's Satan, let's keep away from him. But the deception is that he usually comes as an angel of light. He usually comes as someone who's very friendly, very seductive and very persuasive. That's how many people get fooled by him. And actually the media are actually propagating that seduction by making these programs, believing that Satan can be controlled in some way by spells, by higher forms of magic and higher forms of understanding. And it is a great deception.
Some people say that you've been in the deliverance ministry for 18 years, Michael. Some say that deliverance was really for the Middle Ages and not for today. In our modern age, Christians often feel they can just have psychotherapy and other practices for their problems. How would you answer that?
Well, the Middle Age form of... there was no deliverance in the Middle Age. There was exorcism that really meant casting out. So when people had manifestations of demonic presences in their life, they was usually taken to a Catholic priest. Exorcism comes from the pre-Lutheran days when the only Christian faith was the Catholic faith. And you went through a rite of exorcism where you named all the saints, you named various angels and various things, and it took hours to cast out. They never usually got to the root cause of the problem, because as you know, they burnt witches in those days, they hung, draw and quarter people who dabbled in the occult. And, you know, people who had various psychic powers and skills were automatically branded as witches. So many people kept quiet about these things. These people still went to church and they still carried on as Christians. And the casting out of a devil is different than deliverance. Deliverance is far greater, because deliverance examines the person's lifestyles, the person's life, and it goes to the root cause of their problem. For argument's sake, if someone suffered bullying as a child and they became a victim of bullying, fear gripped them terribly, then they're very prone to fear throughout their life. Exorcism never got to the root cause of that. The only people that were exorcised in the Middle Ages were people who manifested with demons and evil spirits. There aren't many people out there who have demons and evil spirits that only manifest under certain circumstances. And of course, in churches in the Middle Ages, if you manifested, there was the fear that you could be branded as a witch and you could actually lose your life because of it. Joan of Arc was one such. She was branded as a witch in the end and burnt for heresy. So deliverance is far different than exorcism. I know there are certain Catholic churches, the Jesuits, they still carry out exorcism. Many people within the Catholic Church, people like Opus Dei and people like that carry out exorcism. But deliverance is far broader, far wider, and deliverance is for the time now, because many people's demonic infestations come from lifestyle skills or poor choices they've made in the past. Exorcism will never touch that. That's why they need deliverance. Yeah. Psychotherapy and things like that, I'm not necessarily against them, but I do find that when people are demon-obsessed or demonized in some ways, these things can hide and they can adapt through psychotherapy and counseling, and they can remain hidden.
And also, I've noticed that a lot of therapies, like psychotherapy or different therapies, they've often got New Age undertones, or they maybe use meditation as part of the therapy. So there's dangers in a lot of the therapies that even doctors are offering today, whereas deliverance gets to the root of the problem. And
well, Jesus said in the Gospel of Luke, when the 72 returned with joy, they said, "Lord, even the spirits are subject to us via thy name." And Jesus made it clear. He said, "I saw Satan fall like lightning from heaven. I give you authority to trample on snakes, to tread on scorpions." And Jesus was talking at the times when the most fearful of all creatures that you could find in the Judean desert or around the Sea of Galilee would have been a snake or would have been a scorpion, because their bite could have caused death. So Jesus used those terms of the fear of the day. But trouble is with psychotherapy and a lot of these new age things, they mask. They mask, they cover. They give people the illusion that they're okay, because they grant them a form of peace, but it's not the true peace. Yeah. I mean, I truly believe, and as someone who was demonized as a child, someone who was tormented and terrified by demons, I've gone through this experience myself. Jesus is the only lasting way to complete deliverance and freedom from demons and evil spirits.
Amen. Amen. Okay. And do you often find as well that many Christians will say, well, deliverance is only required if you've dabbled in the New Age or the occult, and whereas you've found in 18 years in your experience that there's other reasons why people may need deliverance?
Yeah. I used to watch a program as a child, I'm sure you saw it, called Crackerjack. And when they asked a child a question in Crackerjack, if they got it right, they got a prize. If they got it wrong, they got a cabbage. And you saw some of these kids juggling with an armful of cabbages, and in the end they dropped the cabbages because the weight was too much. Life in itself is a bit like that. Things cling to us and things stay with us. So if we've had a very unhappy childhood and we've gone through abuse, we've gone through bullying, we've gone through rejection at school. I remember before, people from abroad came here, before racism was ever evident at school, I remember children who were ginger, children who had spots, children who looked different than other children, who were picked on, who were called names. I was very dark as a child, and people used to call me Gippo and Gypsy and things like that, because names used to... Yeah. And these things stick to you. They make you feel insecure, and you grow up in life through insecurity, and you wonder if this is just the way you feel. And later on in life, you may suffer depression, manic depression and things like that, and you wonder where the root cause is. Well, the Bible says, in the name of Jesus, every knee shall bow and every tongue shall confess that Jesus Christ is Lord. So whether your problem is a social problem, a lifestyle problem, or a demonic problem, which has come through New Age practices or come through the occult, Jesus Christ is able and will deliver you from all of those things. 2 Timothy 4:18 says, "And the Lord shall deliver me from every evil work and preserve me unto his heavenly kingdom." So evil works are not necessarily occult works. People who have suffered racism, people who have suffered all sorts of bullying throughout their lives, deliverance is the only way to true and lasting freedom.
Amen. I've found a lot of people on YouTube have often contacted me and said that, in their opinion, deliverance isn't just a Christian practice, but that in their own religion they have cast out demons. For example, sometimes mediums tell me that they've cast out demons from other spiritualists. Would you say that is true deliverance, or how would you explain what is going on there?
The first deliverance I ever took part in, earlier on that day, I received the gift of tongues and the anointing of the Holy Spirit. And I went to a church in the evening before there was a crusade on. It was many years ago. I used to work for Don Stewart Ministries, a famous American minister who originally was A.A. Allen's ministry. And there was a crusade in Kennington near the Oval Cricket Ground in London. And I was ushering and I was standing by the bookstore, and two African ladies approached me. They'd been looking at me for a long time. And one lady came to me and said, "Is your name Michael?" And I said, "Yes." And she said, "Would you help my friend?" And I said, "Well, I can't help her. I'm not a pastor. I actually said, I've not been to Bible college. I'm not ordained. Let me go and get a pastor." So this lady said, no, you don't understand. We were told to come to see you." And I said, "Well, who told you to come and see me?" And they said, "The Holy Spirit." And I said at the time, "I doubt that very much. I think you're mistaken. Let me get a pastor." And they said, "No." Anyway, one lady said she had evil within her, and I laid hands on her tummy, and there was movement in her tummy, almost like something was going round and round in her stomach. And I laid hands on her head, and I said, "In the name of Jesus, come out." And she fell to the floor, and she vomited, and she shook for a while. And then she had peace, and she laid still. And a pastor came along and checked her, and he said, "Whatever was there is now gone." The night after, there was a partners meeting in the local town hall, and these two ladies were on the stage giving testimony of being delivered. And this particular lady who was delivered had given her life to the Lord that day. So after, when I spoke to him, I said, "I'm a bit confused. You said you gave your life to the Lord today." I said, "I always thought you was a Christian." And she said, "No, I was a Muslim." I'd been to the mosques, I'd been to see imams to try and cast this thing out. It was a spirit of witchcraft she had, you know. And she said they couldn't cast it out. And I realised it was only in the name of Jesus Christ. You see, Jesus said in his word that we cast down imaginations, tear down strongholds. And only in the name of Jesus, I believe, is total dominion over the demonic and over the supernatural. Yes, maybe you can go to another religion or a New Age practitioner or a medium or somebody like that, and maybe they can help you in some way. I'm not saying they can't. I wouldn't be so ignorant and proud to suggest such a thing. But I think the help is superficial. I don't think the help is deep. Psalm 42 says, "Deep calls to deep at the roar of God's water spouts." And the roar of God's water spouts only come through the name of Jesus, where you get that deep cleansing and that deep release. So yes, I would say maybe psychotherapy, maybe counselling can help people. You certainly wouldn't advise people to go to mediums, because mediums are using familiar spirits and other things to try and cast a demon out. There's a West Indian form of sorcery called Obeah. And West Indians call ghosts or evil spirits duppies. And what they do in Obeah, they get a bigger deity to cast out a smaller deity. So they're getting a bigger demon to cast out a smaller demon. As we know, in the demonic realms, demons know their place. They all have titles, and they never step above their station. And they're always answerable to someone above them. Whereas we're always answerable to Jesus and Jesus Christ alone. So I think only true deliverance can only come in the name of Jesus Christ.
I agree with you, because as you say, the other spirits are still demons.
Still demons.
Even though the practitioners realise that, so they're not actually getting...
I will say that when I used to watch the Most Haunted programme on the TV, which I always found fascinating, when they used to go to old castles and old pubs and haunted inns and things like that, the spirit guides there used to get nearly 100% correct information. They would be given the name of someone who maybe died in that property, who they claim still haunted that property, and they were nearly always right. They all use spirit guides. If you go to a spiritualist church, the leader will have a spirit guide who feeds him information. But I believe that these spirit guides are seducing spirits. They're not going to come in their real form initially, because they'll scare you off. So they come friendly. They come with information. They come with information about your family that only you know, and you're impressed with that information. And they claim this information comes from beyond the grave or the other side. Whereas I now believe that these spirits have been in the families for generations, and they've acquired information and knowledge which they share with other spirits. So you get really sucked into that stuff, believing it's almost godlike, believing it's good, believing it comes from the light, when in my opinion it just comes from the darkness.
Absolutely, and I can testify to that myself, because I was a spiritualist and I saw exactly what you're saying happen to myself and many others. Some people feel that deliverance is only needed for non-Christians, and that if someone accepts Jesus as Lord and Saviour, surely they're automatically set free. What would you say to
that?
Well,
there used to be many arguments, and you remember we spoke about this before with Doug Harris, because it used to be a regularly asked question. When someone accepts Jesus Christ as their Lord and Saviour, they are saved. Now, the book of Jeremiah says, "Heal me and I shall be healed, save me and I shall be saved, for thou art my praise." To be saved is to be set aside from the wrath that's coming. You have moved out of darkness into light. You have gone from famine into feast. What that actually means, that despite of your sinful nature, and, you know, we're told in the Bible there's only one sin that is not forgiven, and that's blasphemy against the Holy Spirit. So you're taken from that place of darkness into light. You are now set aside from the wrath that is coming on the world. If at midnight tonight the world ended, Jesus would say, "This one's for me, this one's for me." And you would not, you would go with the sheep rather than go with the goats. But that doesn't mean that what you've attributed, what's accumulated in your life, the hurt, the pain, the sadness, leaves when you become a Christian. And I think what happens when you become a Christian, sometimes you face up to things that have gone before that may have been a distant memory, things you've never faced up to. And what happens when you become born again, you now get the biggest enemy in the world. You get the devil on your case. When you're in the world and you're sinning, the devil leaves you alone. When I was a young man and I used to go out to football and be involved in football violence and be promiscuous and drink alcohol and take drugs, I never felt the devil close to me, because he didn't have to come close to me, because I was doing the things that he wanted me to do. When I accepted Jesus as my Lord and Saviour and started moving in ministry, the demonic attacks were fast, they were furious, and they came to try and turn me away from what I'm doing now, and they still come now. And I still have to stand there in spiritual warfare in truth. That's why we put on the armour of God. Because when we become a Christian, we come under more attack than we could ever imagine.
And also, I was thinking, when someone becomes a Christian, just because they've asked Jesus into their life, they're not automatically healed of every illness. They're not automatically... They don't stop sinning all of a sudden, so why should all the demons just suddenly leave as well? That they've still got the process of sanctification and holiness and obedience that they need to walk through.
Well, you know, they need that deep cleansing, and that deep cleansing comes from the anointing of the Holy Spirit. And as they start worshipping God, they start reading God's word, they put themselves in a position where the Holy Spirit can then come upon them and deal with many of these things. You know, some people find it strange that when they are a Christian, many people who are asthmatic are still asthmatic. People who are diabetics are still diabetics. There's no guarantee that all of a sudden we're going to wake up bright and new and shiny. Sometimes it takes the rest of our lives to cope with these problems that have accumulated over the years. And it's a miscomprehension. Well, ransomed, healed, restored and forgiven all in one sentence, like the song, Praise My Soul, the King of Heaven. It doesn't happen at once. If it does happen at once, I say, God bless them. They're truly anointed and been of exalted up to the Lord if it happens all at once. Most people it doesn't happen to.
I find it interesting as well, the different testimonies I've heard from people who had deliverance before they knew Jesus, but it was Jesus doing the deliverance.
Yes.
For example, I remember someone I knew years ago in a church, he had been a soldier, and so obviously he had murdered people before, and he found out his wife was committing adultery. So he said a rage overtook him, he was really, really angry, and he wanted to go and murder his wife and the man. So he literally got out the house, went to his car, was about to go and do this deed, when he suddenly fell to the ground and he started manifesting, and a demon came out of him. And even to him it was obvious it was a demon by the way his body reacted. And it turned out that at that precise moment his brother, who was a Christian, was praying for him. And maybe he got revelation, I'm not sure the whole story, but he was set free. And he got off the ground and he went to church and he said, I was about to murder my wife and this man, and he was set free from a spirit of murder. And he then gave his life to Jesus because he realised Jesus is real, he stopped me from murder. So it's not, we can't always put God in a box. Sometimes people get delivered before, and as you said, that Muslim lady got delivered before she came to Jesus.
I'm always impressed by Ian McCormick's story, because he wasn't born again when he got stung by the box jellyfish, and when he ended up in the morgue in the hospital. He said he saw a sign of his, or a vision of his mother actually praying for them, praying for God to deliver him. And you know, he, when he died, or when his human body gave up with all the toxins in, you know, he wasn't born again. But God brought him back. God filled him with the knowledge of Jesus Christ and sent him out there to do what he does now. I mean, I used to be filled with rage. I come from a Romani family. My mother was a Romani gypsy. And we was always taught to extract revenge, that it was how we was brought up. And as a child, I would plot many a month trying to find out ways to extract revenge on people that had offended or had harmed me or the other members of the family. As the eldest son, it was always my, almost my duty to do that. Now I don't care. I would protect my family against the physical threat of violence, but I wouldn't go out there looking for people to harm. You know, so the progressions that you have when you're born again, sometimes the changes come without even you realising it. People can come up to you who you would have took your coat off to and had a fight. I used to do it many times as a child. I used to go on gypsy camps and box bare knuckle, you know, from when I was 10 and 11 years of age. Sometimes box kids that were 15, 16 years of age and be full of anger and vengeance and, you know, the will to succeed and win. Nowadays, people say, have said outrageous things to me. I tend to smile them and say, God bless them. And I no longer have the ability or the will to confront them physically. So change comes over the years. You know, and the more of God's word you read, the more, it's not about going to church, but going to church is essential because we're going to hear God's word. And not only that, you want to go to a place where it's going to be correctly given to you.
Absolutely.
It's not going to be false. You're not going to get some sort of pseudo-prosperity doctrine or, you know, everything you touch you're going to get, or you know, you've got to walk around because you've said the sinner's prayer, believing you're blessed and highly favoured for the rest of your life. You know, Christianity is a real decision and it has to be worked out. And the Bible tells us that it has to be worked out with fear and trembling.
Well, there's sacrifice involved as well, isn't there? And a lot of people don't think of that. They just want bless me attitude and not willing to...
I remember the funniest story I remember years ago about a lady who came to me with problems, and I asked her to accept Jesus as her Lord and Saviour. And she was defrauding the benefit system. And I said, look, I'm going to tell you in advance, for a season you're going to go backwards. Because I'm asking you to stop signing on and claiming benefit, which you're doing very well for, and now work honourably. I said, now, according to what you're telling me, your income's going to go down by a third, just by you not getting the benefits. So you've got to work or find other ways to supplement that income. And for a season, you're going to go backwards, but you mustn't say that God's not with you.
Yeah.
I said, because you've received Jesus Christ in your life, and you've received the greatest gift of all, salvation. And it's very difficult to explain to her.
Yeah.
When we accept Jesus, we go backwards. You know, but we become righteous in that going backwards.
Can you tell me something about ancestral problems? Because many people will say, well, I didn't dabble in New Age or occult. I didn't have huge sins in my life. I didn't have lust problems or violent problems. But maybe their parents did, or their grandparents did. So then they would still need deliverance, you've discovered.
Many people can only go back a couple of generations. And this is a great story. I met a woman once, and I was praying for her, and she manifested terribly, this woman. She used, as soon as you went near her, she used to scream and roar. And many churches she wasn't welcome in, because as soon as the praise and worship started, she would make so much noise that they would put her out. And one day when I was praying for her, I was asked to ask her about her grandmother. And I said, tell me about your grandmother. And she got angry with me. She said, why are you asking about my grandmother? I said, well, tell me about your grandmother. What was your grandmother? She said, a Sunday school teacher. Okay, fair enough. I'll ask you next week. So when she came for prayer next week, I said, tell me about your grandmother. And she got even more angry with me. And when I mentioned her grandmother, she started manifesting. She said, I told you last week my grandmother was a Sunday school teacher. Leave my grandmother alone. So the next week, the first thing I said to her was, tell me about your grandmother. And she went berserk, shouted and screamed, insulted me. She said, I told you about my grandmother. Why do you keep asking about my grandmother? Okay, fair enough, I prayed for her. The next week, I said, tell me about your grandmother. She said, okay, my grandmother was a witch. You see, people want to think well of their ancestors. When they do these programs, Who Do You Think You Are, on the TV, many of them are shocked because they find that their ancestors were not the people they thought they were.
Yeah.
They may have been involved in crime, they may have been involved in scandals and things like that. And because most of what we know about our ancestors is by word of mouth, you know, facts get lost over the years. So for argument's sake, with ancestral curses, my father had an eye for the ladies. He was a ladies' man, my father. As I grew up, I was a ladies' man. I was a ladies' man. I had an eye for the ladies. And I could see where that came from. And my father had never told me to have an eye for the ladies. He'd never suggested anything like that at all. But I developed it through the bloodline. My mother used to have the temper. When my mother was angry, she was a very dangerous woman. And I found that as I was growing up, I developed that anger, and I had these things, and they had come through the ancestral bloodline. You see, when we're attached to the umbilical cord of our mothers, we're receiving nourishment. Not only physical nourishment, we're receiving that spiritual stuff which is coming through the umbilical cord attached to us. So when we're born with this stuff. See, what scientists can't do, we know about DNA. That we have DNA, and our DNA is attached to our parents. Well, with that DNA comes our blood groups and various things. I believe it also our intelligence and the things we learn from our parents spiritually, those invisible things that come down the bloodline. So if there are problems like adultery, anger, bitterness, addiction, I see this a lot with addiction. You see, now, a lot of people say, well, the reason the son's an alcoholic is because he's witnessed his father drinking and he's developed those habits. It's far more than habits. Not everybody chooses to be like their parents before. Some people identify something in their parents and they choose not to be like that.
And some people who were adopted and never knew their parents later find out they have the same characteristics,
yes,
or the same negative traits,
yes,
that their parents had because they've inherited those.
I'll give you an example of ancestral curses that have shown in death and accident and disaster. It's the Kennedy family in America.
Mm-hmm.
If you have a look through the generations of the Kennedys, you will see people who died in accidents, people who died prematurely. And it's a trait with the Kennedys. Now, Rose Kennedy, mother of President John Fitzgerald Kennedy, lived to about 101. Now, she was a good Catholic. She went to Mass all the time. She did everything a good Catholic does. And if you like it says in Psalm 91, with long life will I satisfy them, she was satisfied. She lived to 101. Many of her children didn't. Many of her children died young. Now, the father, shall we say, he was an adulterer. He was involved with Lucky Luciano and the early Cosa Nostra in America. They used to bootleg whiskey over from Ireland during the Prohibition years to sell in the speakeasies in the America. He was involved with these people. And if you like, there was even the famous example where they said he raped the famous silent movie film actress Gloria Swanson. He was never brought to court. They said money was settled out of court. So when his son finally became president, all this stuff was there. We know about President Kennedy and Marilyn Monroe and various affairs he had during his marriage. So you can almost see the stuff that's come through this family bloodline being reborn in the children and the grandchildren. And it hasn't stopped with the Kennedy family.
Yeah.
You know, there's still things going wrong now in the Kennedys.
Yeah.
So I believe that ancestral curses are the silent killer. Someone could say to me, could you come and show me the DNA, the physical scientific evidence of a generational curse? I can't do that. But what you can see it in behavioural traits, in things that we do, which were done before us. And we always get back to the time that we speak well of those who went before us. We don't want to know that we came from gangsters, or we come from people like that.
Yeah.
So we make stories around them. Many gangsters, their ancestors were accountants, if you ask them. Not gangsters, because they handled the money,
yeah,
you see.
Yeah.
So they've become accountants.
That's funny.
You know, and one thing and another. That's where they are.
Yeah. Going back to deliverance, I've heard a lot of people who were mediums and spiritualists that say they didn't have any demonic problems in their house until they actually came to Jesus, because their spirit guides had always been nice before.
Yes.
But once they came to Jesus, that's when the problems started,
yes, yes,
in their house. That's when the so-called spirit guides began to attack them. I've also heard of many mediums and spiritualists who contact me and they say, we don't understand your testimony, Laura, because none of our spirit guides ever attack us. They're always kind to us. And I have to explain, but that's because you're not challenging them.
No.
In Jesus' name. And it's only coming out of spiritualism that your spirit guides will begin,
yes,
to attack,
yes,
you, because they're showing their true colours. Is this something you've discovered as well?
Well, one thing I've noticed, the phenomenon, that if you come out of the occult or you have occult ways, and I realised that I inherited occult ways through the ancestral bloodline. I was speaking to people recently, and I had various skills as a child that I don't have now. For argument's sake, turning the radio on and being able to announce what the next record was and the next record, and I could do it with great accuracy. Being able to predict football match scores, being able to give football results out before I turned on the TV, and all this stuff I used to think was good fun. Good fun. And when I was at school, kids used to think I was some sort of superhuman being with these powers. Now, I don't have those things any longer. But when I became born again and came to the Lord, there was a constant nagging. You think you're born again, you think you're saved, you think. And always asking me to look at being born again, whether I'm really saved or whether I'm kidding myself. Because when you come under control and you're mastered by certain things, whether it be New Age, whether it be spiritualism, whether it be the occult in some ways, they will be very kind to you all the time you're there. Classic example, go to a spiritualist church. This is a very, very sad story, but many, many years ago, I used to arrange mortgages for people, and mainly right to buys when Margaret Thatcher first brought in the legislation for council house right to buy. I must have done about 500 a year, used about 10 a week, and I did it for a family in South East London, and they had a little boy, and this little boy was like a giant. He was the biggest kid I saw, and all he wanted to do was play football. And at 18 months, he was kicking a ball around the house, and he was so robust and big. And his name was Tony, this little boy. And he was fantastic. If you had a son, he was everything a man would want for his son. And, you know, they started going to church, these people. They were going to, I think, a local Baptist church, husband and wife, and they were very happy. The lady rang me up one day and said, Tony's dead, the little boy. He broke his leg a few weeks before, and he had his leg in plaster, and he went to bed one night, and it was considered to be a cot death. And they went there in the morning, and he was dead. And of course, they were distraught, and I was wholly inadequate in trying to support them. You know, they didn't want to hear about God. They didn't want to hear about God's love. All they were saying to me is, why would God take our son? Of course, their next port of call was the spiritualists, who claimed that they had contacted the young boy. He was now in heaven, and he was happy. And the husband said to me, Michael, I'm very worried about it, because she's going all the time. And she's speaking to her son. He was 18 months when he died. And I actually said to her, look, I believe you're being deceived. I don't think you're speaking to your son. Now, at the time, I didn't have the knowledge I have now.
Yeah.
I said, but something seems very, very wrong. And she got angry with me and told me really to mind my own business, which I did do. But I believe these things are there to bring deception. And of course, all the time you're going along with it and you're buying into it, you're going to be left alone. You're going to live a peaceful life. But when you start questioning, and when you question all of these things, you're actually questioning Satan, because I believe he is above all these things.
Yeah.
I believe he is. So you're coming against his authority, which is enforced by demons and strong men and evil spirits. And that's when they're going to start attacking you, because they want you to stay as they are.
Yeah, and they don't like it when you come to Jesus.
I've seen many people who have actually said this to me, that people who have said, before we became a Christian, our lives were happy. People have lost jobs when they've become a Christian. People have had financial difficulty in their life. It seems all hell attacks them and tries to get them to turn away from Jesus Christ back into the life they once knew. Mm-hmm. So, yes, I can understand why mediums say this, but you know, but mediums must understand that there is only one God and he created the universe. And the devil is a created being. He's not the creator. The devil was created like you and I was created. Uh-huh. And nobody can come against its creator. No servant is greater than his master. So, you know, people in the occult need to understand that the devil is not greater than God. And there is an appointed time for Satan. That's another question. Why hasn't God destroyed the devil before now if he knows him to be evil? Mm. But God has put a time span in place. There is an appointed time. And it will come. Mm-hmm. And those who unfortunately choose the devil will go to the place where the devil is.
Yeah.
And there's no escaping that.
I just remembered something. A couple of years back, I phoned you because there was a woman who lived in my town, and her house had spirits in it, and she wanted you and I to pray for her, and I went over to the house and you phoned from London and prayed, and she had spirits in the house that impersonated dead relatives,
yes,
which we know is very common within spiritualism. But not only that, these spirits impersonated living relatives. So, that, you know, she would have relatives come for tea and then leave, and these spirits would show up and look exactly like the living relative and say things and sound and look like the living relatives. So, again, I just feel that emphasises the point. If these demons can impersonate the living people, they can impersonate your dead relatives as well. So you can never trust they are who they're claiming to be, because they're demons. basically?
Look, in entertainment, there are people out there who are impersonators. Mm-hmm. Now, I can remember probably the most famous, we don't see him now, Mike Yarwood. He could impersonate famous politicians, Edward Heath, Harold Wilson, who was Prime Minister at the time. If in the human characteristics there is the ability to change our voice, mm-hmm. to even change our appearance to make us look like somebody, then demons and evil spirits who are not of the physical world, they're of the supernatural realms, then they can take the voice of one of our ancestors, even someone who's alive, take the appearance, and they can mislead us and fool us, you know, and that's what they do.
Yeah. It's sad that a lot of mediums don't realise that that's
No, of course. I mean, I looked in the mirror one morning, I got up to go to work, and I looked in the mirror, and as I looked in the mirror, I saw my father staring at me. And I went like that quickly, and it was my father staring at me as he looked. And I went like that, shut my eyes, and he had gone. And I never knew at the time what that was, and I thought to myself, but there we go, I was missing my father, my heart was breaking for him, I still miss him every day, and he wasn't a great Christian, he was a lapsed Roman Catholic, but he was a good man and I enjoyed his company. And I think through that anxiety, through that sadness, through that longing and that missing, that is an open door for these sort of things to exploit and to come. And when you've suffered bereavement like this poor couple did with their son, that is a time for the devil to move in and exploit the occult, exploit supernatural understanding of mediums, of soothsayers, of clairvoyance. We should point out that before the children of Israel went into the land that God had promised them, in Deuteronomy 18, God spoke of these things and he said, do not take up these practices of those in the land who listen to soothsayers and clairvoyance. So in other words, the Canaanites, or the people who lived in the land of Canaan, these tribes, they used to consult mediums, consult soothsayers, consult spiritualists, you know, for information all the time. God forbid it. He said, don't take up these customs. He said, anyone who does these things are an abomination before the Lord. You see, what it's down to is, who do you believe? If you're not going to wait for the Holy Spirit to impart information on you, if you're impatient or you need answers immediately, and you go to these places, you will get answers, but you will be deceived.
Well, that's it, and the source isn't godly, it's demonic.
Mm-hmm. It's demonic, yeah.
Changing the topic slightly, in the last 18 years in your ministry, have you noticed more need for deliverance from sexual sin since our society has become more liberal with sexual practices?
Well, to be honest with you, I'm 62 years of age now, and I can't recognise Britain now as I did when I was a child. Living in South London, a very poor part of South London, and being brought up with people who were poor around me, one thing that people did, they did have church, and apart from the big Anglican and Catholic churches, in most streets in South East London, there may only be Nissen huts where there was Wesleyan halls or Pentecostal halls, but people used to go to church. And marriage, if you like, was for life. I'm not saying adultery never happened. Mm-hmm. Somebody told me once that what changed Britain was the Second World War. It changed people's understanding of life, and many people, when their husbands was away abroad, they were struggling to keep their children fed and keep them clothed. The American servicemen came over in the war, you know, laden with dollars, chocolate, nylons and all these things, and people's understanding of what life was about was particularly changed. And, you know, when the 50s came up, we was very austere in the 50s. You can remember what used to come on TV. You didn't have Radio 1 or Capital Radio or any of these programs. You had the home service, the light network, and you had these things. And you even had Radio 4 that mainly had religious programs on all day long. And in the 60s in particular, things changed. We became liberated. Now, I was a child of the 60s and I loved any minute of it. And if someone had told me in the 60s that this stuff was going to destroy society or destroy the fabric of society, if you like, sex, drugs and rock and roll, I would have laughed at them. I'd have said, well, we're just having a good time. And we're just living these liberated days that were never here. You look at fashions in the 50s, until Teddy Boys came out in the rock and roll movement, you know, young men had short back and sides haircuts, and they wore Harris tweed jackets and Cavalry Trill trousers and, you know, like that. And with youth culture and music and came rebellion, and rebellion led them away from what they'd been brought up to. And now we have liberated days where it's not looked upon sinful to have sex outside marriage. It's not looked upon to be sinful in some quarters to have your children before marriage. I've met people with three or four children by two or three different partners. I met a man recently who claimed he was being called by the Lord to serve the Lord. And when we looked in his sexual background, he had actually fathered over five children by three different women. And he couldn't seem to see the need for breaking those soul ties and breaking the links with what he had done before. He basically felt that God had descended on him, called upon him, and he was waiting to go into ministry. And I believe now, I mean, this is very sobering. Many years ago, I was called to see a pastor who was manifesting very, very badly. And he asked me to come and see him very, very quietly. He didn't want his church to know, of course, what was going on. And he manifested very, very badly. And as we took him through deliverance, we found he had 50 previous sexual partners before he married his wife. And some of these partners may have been in the occult. Some of them may have been women who were sleeping with various men at the time. And we found out that that was the link to the demonic problems he had. And when we broke the sexual soul ties, and he couldn't remember the names of all the women, so we had to do it corporately.
Yeah.
And when we broke the sexual soul ties with these women, he was finally set free. So I believe sexual behaviour is true. And God says in his word that no fornicator has any part in the kingdom of heaven, because a fornicator is an idolater. In other words, he idolises the human body and the sexual act. And that is what he gives himself up to all the time. So, you know, churches, I believe churches should teach morals as they used to be.
Yeah.
And they should teach marriage and the sanctity of marriage.
Yeah.
And, you know, these are liberated days. You hear certain stars, a famous Coronation Street star admitted that he'd slept with over 1,000 women in his life. Well, I thought that was a dreadful thing to come on the TV. I don't know if he wanted people to clap him and to think he was a super, you know, stud or something like that. But I think that sort of thing's appalling. Appalling sort of things.
And have you found, talking about soul ties, when some couples get married, that if they've had sex with partners before they got married, they might need the soul ties cut?
Absolutely.
Because they can have problems in their lives until that's dealt with. I remember you told me yesterday there was a woman. You went to visit her home because she was having a lot of demonic activity in her house, and she herself hadn't dabbled in the occult.
No.
But she slept with a man who had, and therefore
yes,
the soul tie had came and gave her the same occult problems that he had.
If I broaden the story, this particular was a lovely lady, and she was going to church and she was living a good life as a Christian, and she found sometimes she felt a restriction on her throat. And I said, really? She said, yes, I feel like there's hands around my throat when I lay in the bed of a
night,
and I'm choking. Anyway, I sat there and prayed for her, and I said to her, have you got any love letters from this man? Have you got any mementos? And she said, I have. And she brought down a box full of letters he had sent her after they'd packed up. Anyway, she told me that he was a little bit deviant, that, you know, when they were together in intimate, he at times put his hand on her throat. And after he had left, many years after, she still had this feeling. So anyway, we took all the letters down and I ripped them all up one by one. And as the letters was ripped up, I broke the soul ties with this man and she received deliverance and it stopped. So I do believe that a tie, a sexual soul tie, you see, the Bible says, would you join with a harlot? It says, would you join with a harlot? And when a man and a woman become one, I think they don't only become one physically, I believe they become one emotionally and spiritually. famous saying, you never forget your first love. You never forget your first love. I was given a vision by God over this, that, whoever takes a lady's virginity has a spiritual power over for many years after. And that has to be broken.
Unless it's cut.
It has to be cut. Otherwise she can go, I had problems in my own marriage at first. And, you know, I wondered where these problems came from. It was only when we went into deep into it that we realised there were still soul ties in place and they had to be broken.
Can you tell me some reasons that cause people's homes to be demonised, and how often are you asked to go and cleanse homes in Jesus' name?
Lots of times we're asked to cleanse homes. People doing witchcraft on you is an obvious thing, and sending things against you. It was quite amusing. I spoke to someone who used to go and see witches and of such. And in the old days, they used to ask for a memento. Could you leave something with me? So after you've gone, they can use that as a point of contact.
Yeah,
it might be, I don't know. I mean, I've got a bank card here, but it might be a photograph or an item of jewellery. He said, now, when you go to see witches now, they have a Polaroid camera and they take a photograph of you when you go in there now, and they put it on a file. So now they have something constantly. Now, what I found out about witchcraft, when you go to a witch and you say, I have a particular problem in my home, and she will say, go home and burn sage in your house. Burn sage and let the aroma go up, or whatever they say. Naturally, it's not in their interest for you to be set free, because you're not going to see them any longer. So it's in their interest for you to keep coming back to them, because they're charging you 50, 60, 70, 80, 90, £100 a time. So they want you to go back. So it's not in their interest to set you free. And I've found many, many people have gone to see such people, and they find the infestation in their homes are worse. So yes, there are occult reasons why you get this thing, if you like, poltergeist activity, things like that in the house, darkness in the house, hazes in the house, cold spots in the house. But there's also other reasons as well. You have to be careful what you bring into your house. Many people go to antique fairs and they buy things, curios and antique.